Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Roadie on the Horn podcast. My name, as always, is Donovan, and I'm here with my co-host who lives in Iowa, sometimes in Illinois. It depends how he's feeling. Ryan, how are you doing today?
You know, I'm doing great, Donnie. Honestly, I'm excited to get into a lot of sports talk today, as we do on our podcast. So, I mean, yeah, I'm excited. I'm in Iowa now. I'm going back to Illinois for Thanksgiving next week. But, yeah, I mean, that's kind of what I got going on right now.
Hey, I mean, you can't really complain. You know, I'm sure your drive isn't too bad. But, you know, obviously, we have a good amount to talk about in sports this week. Obviously, another week of football has gone by, but there are some things happening in basketball and other sports as well. If you want to just hop right into it, what do you want to talk about first this week?
Yeah, let's do it. As you said, we got a bunch of sports to go over this week, so looking forward to it. But I want to start in the NFL, as we have been lately. Obviously, football season, that's kind of the focus of a lot of people, especially me right now. So I want to start with kind of an interesting situation that I was kind of reading about the last few days relating to Yannick Ngakoue. Obviously, we talked about the Yannick Ngakoue trade a few weeks ago where he went from Minnesota to Baltimore. But obviously, before the Vikings, he was with the Jacksonville Jaguars. So actually, there is kind of an interesting situation going on with looking back at that Jaguars-Vikings trade relating to Ngakoue. So let me kind of break it down here. So included in the trade that sent Yannick Ngakoue from Jacksonville to Minnesota was a conditional pick that relied on Yannick Ngakoue making the Pro Bowl. So if Yannick Ngakoue makes the Pro Bowl this year, the Jaguars will receive a fourth-round pick instead of a fifth-round pick. So obviously pretty small, but the kind of caveat with that is the Pro Bowl voting is fan vote. So there was a Jaguars fan on Reddit, and he was recruiting other NFC North fans, so the Bears, the Packers, the Lions, all of their fans on Reddit, to be voting for Yannick Ngakoue to make the Pro Bowl, so that way the Jaguars get the higher pick between them and the Vikings. And then I kept reading more about this. I was like, okay, that's kind of a, you know, an interesting situation. Like, this Jaguars fan wants to get Ngakoue into the Pro Bowl so they get an extra pick. And then the most stunning part of all of this, I was reading more about the Pro Bowl, and I found out that the Pro Bowl this year is going to be entirely on Madden. I had no idea of this. I found an article. I didn't even, like, know this was information that was released. But the Pro Bowl is going to be entirely on Madden. They're going to have, like, this, like, week-long event of, like, NFL legends and content creators in the Madden community just, like, playing a bunch of different games and getting people involved on Madden. Like, obviously, the concern there is COVID-related. Obviously, that's why they can't have a Pro Bowl in person. But I was just like, this entire situation where this Jaguars fan on Reddit is trying to get the Jaguars a higher pick between them and the Vikings, and then he's trying to send him to the Pro Bowl that's entirely on Madden. So, I mean, just this entire situation was just so stunning to me. But yeah, Donnie, I want to get some of your thoughts. What is running through your mind when you heard about this with Yannick Ngakoue?
Okay, so you sent me this, and I was shocked and appalled, really. I just didn't know what to say. And then I read into it. I looked it up on Twitter, and it looks like everybody else is very confused, too. Nobody else really knew what was going on. Just the weirdest thing. It's like, I understand they want to do something, but I always look at the Pro Bowl as like a money hungry money grab kind of thing, because like obviously it's just for TV and all that, it's for people to watch, you know. And now they're doing it on Twitch, which I guarantee you they will have 7 viewers the entire time. Like who cares, especially if it's on Madden. Like, you can't even play dodgeball. If you can't play dodgeball, what am I here for? What is my motivation, as Creed Bratton would say? And yeah, I don't know. It's the weirdest, most, I didn't know this existed until 20 minutes ago when RK sent me this in DMs, and I got nothing for you. This is a live reaction to me telling you I have no idea what's going on.
Yeah, it was a weird situation. We talked a few podcasts ago after Ngakoue was traded then again from the Vikings to the Ravens. So now a Jaguars fan is voting for a Ravens defensive end, so that way the Vikings send them an extra pick. So yeah. That is a very weird situation. Ngakoue, actually, he's like 20th in the NFL in sacks. So not awful, but definitely not Pro Bowl caliber. But yeah, I mean, I guess the moral of the story is stop making conditional trades based on fan votes in a Pro Bowl. Like, Minnesota Vikings, what are you doing there? How did you put yourself in this kind of situation? I don't recall anything else like this. So yeah, that was kind of a funny situation. We're going to find out what goes on in Madden. Donnie was talking about Madden earlier. Like, Keenan Allen is one of the, obviously, NFL players who he plays Madden a good amount. Like, I've watched him stream on Twitch before. There's been a few other players that have done that. And he was like tweeting earlier this year that he was like, man, I'm done with Madden. Madden is trash this year. So I don't know if Keenan Allen's getting involved in the Pro Bowl on Madden, but yeah, just kind of a weird situation. I wanted to start the podcast off with that, but yeah, funny situation there with Yannick Ngakoue. But We can now shift over now to other things that we saw this past weekend in the NFL. Donnie and I, our two favorite football teams, played again this weekend, and the Giants, they beat the Eagles over the weekend. Daniel Jones actually played pretty solid. I got to give him his credit. He looked pretty nice in that game, not going to lie, a little bit. Giants snapped an 8-game losing streak to the Eagles, so I couldn't tweet out my usual tweet after the Giants-Eagles games of the Eagles dominance. So, Donnie, I got to take a step back. The Giants got to win. I know you're not too thrilled about Giants wins because you want losses for the tank, but hey, I gotta shift it over.
Okay, so as I've said all season, it is not a win. It is a loss for me mentally. You know, we specifically are looking to, as Giants fans, we're looking for a little bit of rebuild here. I think that's been established. We kind of need some help. And quarterback is an issue. And I don't feel as if winning, especially a division game against the Eagles that I know you care about more than I cared about, because you like posting the record on Twitter and saying, oh, we did this, you know, we have more wins in the all-time series. And you know, I sit here and just I shake my head. But yeah, winning is the least, I don't know, it's like the least good thing that they could have done. And it really bothers me that we are at a point where the team decided to pull one out when they haven't pulled one out the last four or five games of season to where they were close games. Like, you know, obviously the Dallas game, they could have beat Tampa, they could have beat Pittsburgh, they could have beat Chicago. They lost all those games. They decide the one game they have to beat is the one game they have to win is the team in front of them in the division that is just absolutely awful, and the entire division stinks, and it gives them a chance to win the division when they should be looking for the number one pick. Yeah, I think most Giants fans will agree that this is basically useless to me. And you know, it was nice seeing a win, but do I really care? The answer is no.
Yeah, it was an interesting game. Every time the Giants and Eagles played, like, Jim Schwartz's defense for the Eagles is primarily, like, middle of the field close. Like, usually you'll see Roddy McLeod down there, middle of the field. So the Giants, they just hammer slant routes. Like, every time the Eagles and Giants play, it's slant route, slant route, slant route, and then they try to hit them with, like, a double move. Darius Slayton had a good game, so got to give him his credit there. But yeah, I mean, it's like you got a situation with the Giants where you have a first-year head coach and a young quarterback. So like, I feel like sometimes those teams, even if they're necessarily like bad, like towards the end of the year, sometimes they can kind of figure out some games. So Giants were able to get that. But I have some other Eagles thoughts with that, just going off of that. We saw a little bit of Jalen Hurts in this game, but I still feel like the Eagles are kind of using Jalen Hurts in weird ways. Obviously, they're trying to just kind of bring him in organically and develop him, but they only have used him throwing the ball twice so far this year. I would like to see that a little bit more. I think I kind of see two sides of thoughts when I was thinking about this with Jalen Hurts. And one of them is you paid Carson Wentz all this money. You're paying him like an average of like $30 million a year over the course of his contract. So when you're calling a pass play, I think it would make sense that you want Carson Wentz to be the one throwing the ball instead of Jalen Hurts. But then kind of my other side of that thinking when it comes to development is, or do you actually want Jalen Hurts to be developing, be trusted as a passer, and be utilized more as a dual threat? Because as of right now, what the Eagles are doing is they're just sending out Jalen Hurts for like one play in a drive, and they're running read option. And for some reason, like they're fumbling a bunch of snaps, or like those aren't really going that well. There was a game a few weeks ago when they played the Ravens, and they had one drive where they used Wentz and Hurts for probably like six or seven plays in a row, and it actually looked pretty good. Like they were moving the ball a little bit, but I haven't seen that enough from the Eagles since. It's pretty much just like they'll just use Hurts for like one play on a drive, as I was saying. So I kind of see two sides of thought on that. As I mentioned on this podcast before, I'm a big Jalen Hurts fan. I think he has a lot of potential. I would like to see him develop, obviously. I would like to see him be trusted to throw the ball a little bit more, but I also see the other line of thought in that if you paid Carson Wentz all this money, you're going to want him to be the one throwing the ball. So I don't know. I just had kind of some thoughts on that with Jalen Hurts. Donnie, do you have any comments on what kind of line?
Yeah, I don't know. I would say that you're not worrying until next year and you see how they use him next year. Because I think as a rookie, there's still a lot of, obviously going from college football to the pros, there is a massive, massive learning curve. And I don't know. Jalen Hurts was not necessarily a top tier quarterback in the draft this year. So while, you know, obviously you would like to see some other usage, especially because Carson Wentz has not been very good. I think it's the same thing with what I dealt with like, say, the Rangers, for example. So, like, they would play Mark Stahl or Dan Girardi over promising young talent. And I think the comparison makes a lot of sense because we see in sports a lot there is pressure from management and there is pressure from ownership. Obviously, if they're paying this money, they want to see this guy play. So you're not going to see Jalen Hurts really take a role unless Carson Wentz is either off the team or he gets hurt. And I don't think you're rooting for an injury, obviously. So I would say wait until next year, see how they utilize him because they'll have a year under his belt. They'll know his strengths, know his weaknesses. I don't know. I wouldn't worry about it so much this year, especially because this year is a loss. It's a loss year for every NFC East team. I think that's well established.
Yep. I would agree. Yeah.
I wouldn't stress so much on it this year. I'd say next year, if they use him in a similar capacity, then you think, oh, maybe this is a wasted pick, or maybe he's not going to pan out, or maybe they think he's not that good. But for now, I wouldn't be too worried.
Yeah, I like those comms there. Because, yeah, I would like to see Jalen Hurts a little bit, you know, take some strides as a passer. I think his senior year at Oklahoma, he did some nice things throwing the ball. As you said, I mean, he's not the greatest passer in the world. He's not Justin Herbert. He's not Tua. He's not Joe Burrow throwing the ball, but he definitely has a good skill set that I think they could be using a little bit differently. I would like to see a little bit more where they're using Hurts for like a couple plays in a row on a drive, like they did that one time against the Ravens that I'm bringing up.
Would you prefer him in like a Taysom Hill role, more usage like that, more I don't know, having him in different packages and different I don't know. Taysom Hill seems to be like their Swiss Army knife, almost. Like they can hand the ball off to him. He can line up beside Drew Brees or whoever the quarterback is because they have injuries. Would you rather see him in a role like that and see how he works, maybe as more of a runner than anything?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting thought. And I feel like Taysom Hill is kind of like that gold standard or whatever you want to say. Like he was kind of that first guy that's like, oh, wow, an NFL team is using a backup quarterback as a part of their offense. And I think with Taysom Hill, they're really just using him as a runner. Like I think that situation that I was talking about with how you already paid Wentz, that's kind of what the Saints see. If the Saints want to run a pass play, Drew Brees should be the one throwing the football. I know he's injured now, so it'll be Jameis, but I think they do a good job of working in. I don't think that's a direct parallel with Hurts. I still think Jalen Hurts is a quarterback. Like I still think you want to use Jalen Hurts throwing the ball. Like I think that is an area that he is better than Taysom Hill, rather than maybe like a pure runner. Because even with the Saints, like sometimes you'll see Taysom Hill like running routes, like they'll line him out wide or in the tight end and throw him passes. Like the Eagles have tried that before. Like they had one play where they like threw Jalen Hurts a pass or like some weird stuff like that. Like I don't know. I would rather see like a good amount of like read option RPOs with Jalen Hurts, but I want to see him throwing the ball a little bit more. But yeah, that's definitely a good thought you brought up there, because Hill seems to always be that prime example that people turn to when it comes to using a backup quarterback.
Yeah, I don't know. The usage thing is weird, and I still think the pick is strange, but if he's going to be their future, I don't know. It makes sense. I don't know. I wouldn't worry about it so much. You see teams across the league not really use their backup quarterbacks regardless, or their drafted young quarterbacks regardless. It's like, look at the Packers, for example. Aaron Rodgers having a great year, so it's a little bit different. However, Jordan hasn't played. He probably hasn't played a single snap in the regular season, I'm assuming. I could be wrong with that. But, yeah, it's just, I don't know. It's development's sake. I think everybody's established that having an extra year under your rookie quarterback's belt to really fit in makes sense. And it's not like, I don't know. I wouldn't worry about it so much beginning early on. I think next year would be the telltale sign more than anything, especially if Carson Wentz is bad next year.
Yeah, definitely agree. And I think that is also a valid point that you brought up when you look at the Packers and Eagles comparison. Like Carson Wentz, he's had his moments where he's good, but he's had way too many plays that have been turnover worthy. I know PFF put out a stat that he leads the league in that category. So obviously not what you want. You want a little bit more production out of that position. So just kind of a thought I had while watching some Eagles games recently. So good conversation there. Win for the Giants on the field. Maybe not a win for the Giants off the field going into the draft. So yeah, funny thought. Eagles still lead that division at 3-5-1. So yeah, as we're saying, terrible division. We knew that. I was saying 6 wins for the NFC East. I may have to bump that down to like 4 or 5 at this point. It's really, really bad. Eagles are at Cleveland this Sunday. So looking forward to that. We've got more NFL thoughts later. Obviously, we're going to talk about the DeAndre Hopkins catch when we get into some of our questions. But we do have other thoughts on other sports. Before we get into that, I want to go next over now to the NBA. So at time where you're listening to this podcast, the NBA draft has concluded. At time for Donnie and I right now, the NBA draft is happening later tonight. So we're looking forward to that. We'll get into some NBA draft thoughts in a little bit. And of course, in our next podcast, we can break that down a little bit more. But we do have actual news that has happened in real time for us at this point in time. First note in the NBA, Chris Paul being traded from the Oklahoma City Thunder to the Phoenix Suns. Thought this was an interesting move. Oklahoma City gets Ricky Rubio and Kelly Oubre. So I thought that was a good ad for Phoenix. I think Phoenix is kind of a team that they've really just stockpiled a bunch of talent because they've had a ton of super high picks, but it has never turned out on the court. They've never figured out a way to get wins on the actual basketball court. So I think Chris Paul was a good ad. I think he'll be a good point guard for him. I still thought he was pretty good in the playoffs last year. It was pretty much just he and a bunch of randoms on that Thunder team last year, but Chris Paul still kind of got things done. So I like that ad a lot for Phoenix.
Chris Paul's a talented player. I mean, nobody's really arguing on that. I do think it's the fit makes a lot of sense. And for Chris Paul's sake, I'm sure he's happy because as somebody said, he wanted to go closer to home, which is Los Angeles, where his family is. So it makes a little bit more sense for him to be. That's an hour flight home. He'll be fine. But I don't know. I don't think the Suns are necessarily like a contender or anything now, but I do think it would be nice to see a Suns team that is finally a little bit more competitive than the teams we've had the last, what, 2, 3, 4, 5 years. It's like I feel like since they had Nash and Steve Nash and Amari Stoudemire, they've been basically useless. Obviously, they've got pieces like Devin Booker and DeAndre Ayton are very, very good. But I don't know. The more competitiveness and the more parity, the better. And, you know, the Suns were very, very good in the bubble last year. I believe they didn't lose a game. I think they were at 8-0, which is very hard to believe considering they were playing only playoff teams and teams that were generally better than them standings-wise. I don't know. Chris Paul is the type of guy you want your young players to be building around and learning from. So I would definitely say that it's a big dub for them, especially because they didn't really give up that much.
Yeah, I totally agree. I like that ad for Phoenix a lot. Funny to me that you brought up the bubble Suns, the undefeated bubble Suns. They were such a funny team to watch. They didn't even get into the playoffs, but they were undefeated. It reminds me of the Summer League Bulls. Like, the Bulls always, they're obviously, like, they're terrible once we hit the regular season, but the Summer League Bulls, you got to watch out. The Bulls in the Summer League are not messing around. They won a championship, like, a few years ago, so everybody likes to talk about that, so kind of funny. Couple other moves in the NBA we saw this week. The Milwaukee Bucks made a few moves trying to clear cap to re-sign Giannis. They add Drew Holiday from the New Orleans Pelicans, send out Eric Bledsoe and George Hill. So I thought that was one of the interesting moves that they made. They also traded Dante DiVincenzo, Ersan Ilyasova, and DJ Wilson to the Kings and got Bogdan Bogdanovic. So a few moves for the Bucks, really, again, just clearing cap so they can make that push to keep Giannis. So thoughts for you on that, Donnie? I know for me, I kind of thought that Giannis was probably on his way out, especially after an early playoff exit in the bubble. But it seems like the Bucks are making a push to keep him.
Yeah, it's a real wait and see for me, I think, with Giannis. I would say that he was probably better off leaving. Milwaukee, not the best sports city. Milwaukee probably does not have the capital that Giannis would want around him in terms of adding another superstar or two, and I think he could get it done going elsewhere. However, you know, adding pieces, the Bucks were very, very good last year, and they're just getting better. Obviously, you would like to see them be able to win a playoff series here and there. Not necessarily Giannis' fault. A lot of injuries and such occurred there in the bubble, but I don't know. I would say more than anything, it's a last-ditch attempt to try to, like, you know, persuade him to stick around. Obviously, I think Drew Holiday is a good add. He's a very talented piece. Maybe not the most efficient player in the world, but he will help out. And I do think with the Bucks, they already have their set core of talented pieces there. So just adding on a couple more guys that can do their job and not really cost you. I don't know. There's a lot of interesting pieces that they could have added, and I'm not necessarily sure that Bogdanovic and Drew Holiday were the ones that they should be going after. But you can't really complain, especially if you are a Bucks fan. I think you are going to lose Giannis. I think that's essentially going to happen, whether you like it or not, unless they happen to make a magical run. But I would say teams like that, adding talent, you can't really complain. It's more depth and it's more talent for a roster that was the best team in the league last year in the regular season. I don't know. I would say the Bucks probably, they're making moves to make moves to try to do anything to keep Giannis. And I mean, I guess you have to respect it.
Yeah, I agree. I think kind of the focus of those trades was more about the cap space than the quality of players. Not that Drew Holiday is trash, but I think if you want, obviously, Giannis, one of the top, you know, three players in all of basketball, you're going to want to surround him with some more talent if you really want to compete for a championship. So interesting moves there, but seems like the Bucks are trying to make an effort there. But yeah, I kind of see your point there. Like, it just doesn't seem like Giannis is necessarily going to be there long term. Like, even if he signs an extension and they have a few more years where it's early playoff exits, Giannis is probably going to want to get traded or something like that, at least in my opinion. So interesting to follow that. Few other notes out of the NBA now that we can touch on. Next one relates to James Harden. So he actually has a lot of trade rumors surrounding him with the Rockets. He rejected a 2-year deal worth over $50 million per, which would have made him the highest paid player per year ever in the NBA. And he said no. There were some talks that James Harden was saying that, oh, it's not, I don't play basketball for the money, which is fair. I mean, the Rockets haven't also, speaking of teams that haven't won championships, I mean, the Rockets are in that category. Harden hasn't won it there. So a lot of rumors of him wanting to go to the Brooklyn Nets, team up with KD and Kyrie. That would be really interesting. There were also some rumors that I read came from Fox News. So obviously you have kind of an interesting caveat there. But Rick Bucher was talking about how part of the reason James Harden didn't want to re-sign with the Rockets is that their owner, Tillman Fertitta, is a Donald Trump supporter. So I don't know how valid that logic is in James Harden wanting to leave a full organization, but I just read that today, thought I would bring it up here. But yeah, Donnie, any thoughts on kind of what's going on with James Harden and potentially going on to the Brooklyn Nets?
Yeah, I don't think it'll end up happening. There's not enough meat on the bone for the Rockets. They do not have their first round picks for a couple years. So if they did decide to tank, it would basically be what the Nets did with the Celtics, adding on older talent, giving up their first, and then they would turn up. They were pretty bad. They got high level picks from it. It would be a mistake. I think, if I'm the Rockets, I try to add talent. I don't try to subtract talent. Maybe Russell Westbrook would be a decent piece to move, considering he has semi-fell off. He is not the same player he was a couple years ago when he was getting a double-double or triple-double every game. I don't know. I don't see it happening. The Nets don't really have that type of talent to move for a James Harden-type player, unless they want to trade basically everybody that's not Kyrie and KD, which would basically make their team irrelevant and useless, considering it's shown that in the NBA you need a lot of depth to be able to win. You need to have these guys that can come in late game, play defense, do whatever you want. I just think the fit doesn't make sense. KD and Kyrie are already very ball dominant, one-on-one, I'm the number one guy type players, and adding Harden, who is literally the definition of ball dominant, one-on-one, I am number one guy type player, maybe not the best move. I can see why the Nets would want to do it, considering it would give them maybe the best big three we've ever seen in basketball, although LeBron, Wade, and Bosch is pretty much up there. I don't know. I think that I would assume that Harden ends up on the Rockets and is playing for the Rockets this year. If he hits free agency, so be it. You know, it's like you can only control so much. And if they made a trade, that would be detrimental to them without picking up pieces that would help. It'll put them in the same position anyway.
Yeah, I like your analysis there when it comes to the ball dominant aspect. I think that is really an important aspect of this. Like if you went to the Nets, you have KD, very ball dominant player, obviously, like you said, James Harden and Kyrie Irving. Like we were talking earlier about Chris Paul. I think if Chris Paul was in that mix instead of, say, Kyrie or something like that, then you have a good facilitator there. But yeah, I mean, as you said, it would be a stacked big three. I mean, those are three definitely top, top caliber players in the NBA when you talk about KD, Kyrie, and Harden. But we'll see if that ends up coming to fruition. Has not ended up happening yet, but still an interesting situation to follow. Last note of the NBA we got relates to your Lakers, Donnie. They get Dennis Schroeder. Big ad. The champions, the rich get richer. You get Dennis Schroeder. I mean, are you putting up the 2020-21 banner because of the Dennis Schroeder ad already?
No, but Danny Green's gone, so I mean, I can't complain. Danny Green literally stayed.
Addition by subtraction right there.
That guy cannot shoot, and it really bothers me because I was very excited to have him on the team. And I don't know, it really showed when Avery Bradley's role was taken by Danny Green that it wasn't going to work. Danny Green is not Avery Bradley. Avery Bradley can actually shoot. Danny Green was missing threes like crazy. He was a big meme on Twitter. He played his part. He did his job, and I give him respect for that. But Dennis Schroeder is a considerably better player, and playing with LeBron, everybody gets better. Somehow Danny Green got worse. So again, addition by subtraction, it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, there you go. I thought Danny Green was a good ad too. It didn't work out, but maybe next year he'll wind up on some other team. Maybe the Nets. Maybe he'll wind up on the Nets next year.
Yeah, sure. Why not? Hey.
Yeah. More ball dominant players. Just what they're looking for right there. But yeah, that sums up most of our NBA thoughts. As we said, NBA draft going on for us tonight. So we'll look forward to talking about that in our next podcast. Before we get into our questions, just a few notes out of the MLB. Obviously, it's off-season time in MLB. We haven't had a ton of free agency news yet, but we have a few executive news. Big news for the Chicago Cubs. Theo Epstein, their team president, decided to step down. His contract was set to expire at the end of next year, but he felt that it was the right time for him to step down right now. Their general manager, Jed Hoyer, is just going to step up and take his role. I read an article on The Athletic that talked about Theo's just kind of like his motives. He wrote like a nice letter to all the kind of the Cub staff on why he was making this decision. And he was saying, he's like, well, I mean, my contract's set to expire at the end of next year, but we kind of already know that Jed Hoyer is going to take over for me. So it's not like he needs me looking over his shoulder or anything like that. We can just kind of make this move now. So part of that I do respect. I mean, when it comes to Theo Epstein, he did his job as team president of the Cubs. He delivered a World Series, something that hadn't been done in over 100 years. So big respect to Theo, one of my favorite people in all of sports to listen to talk. I always think about Theo's initial press conference with the Chicago Cubs. That's like a video I've gone back and listened to a bunch. Theo's a great person to listen to his press conferences. Goes in such great detail on some of his thought processes. But yeah, just going back to that initial press conference he had with the Cubs back in like 2011 or when he took over, he was just kind of talking about how building teams kind of works. And he was like, it all comes down to your player personnel. You need to be scouting the right players, taking a look at all aspects of them, including their character. That was a big part of so many of the Cubs players that they've drafted, like Chris Bryant, Kyle Schwarber, Javi Baez. Like, I feel like they always looked at players' character as well as their on-field ability. And then it comes down to development as well. I think that's something that the Cubs did really well, not only identifying good players, but then bringing them up through their minor league system and putting them in positions to have success. So big respect for Theo, one of my favorite executives, as I was saying. So unfortunate to see him stepping down, but nothing but good things for me as I reflect on Theo's time with the Cubs.
Yeah, I feel like Theo is one of those guys that just wants a new challenge over and over, and obviously he's 2-for-2 in his challenges so far, so you can't really discredit him. I don't know, guys like that who are so entangled with baseball and have been so deeply, I don't know, their whole life is motivated by baseball. Sometimes you just need a break, and I feel like if you're taking a break, now is probably the time to do it, especially with COVID and everything. It's a little bit more difficult to be able to communicate with people. It's a little bit more difficult to just function as a human being. So I think it makes a little bit more sense for him to step down, and I'm sure that he'll take a little bit of time off and then find another gig. I'm sure there's teams out there that would pay handsomely for his services, considering he is, one of the top couple baseball minds in the world right now. Maybe all time, honestly, considering he is just such a talented thinker, such a talented decision maker. As a Cubs fan, you know, you can't really be upset. He has brought you success, and he is a big part of the reason why they are still a good team. You know, I think, I don't know, the Cubs will be fine. He will be fine. Everybody will be fine. I would assume that Theo is in another position somewhere else by maybe the end of next season, something along those lines.
Yeah, that's what it sounded like in that article that I read on The Athletic. Theo was talking about how he actually had interested in getting involved in an ownership group. So thought that was interesting. But yeah, it sounded like he wanted to take this season off. I know the Mets and Phillies are looking for new executives, but seemed like Theo kind of turned that down, saying, I want to take a year off. He said he was like, I've been in baseball for like 30 years. I haven't had a summer to myself. So Theo's like, all right, I'm just going to take a step back. So much respect for Theo. Everything he does, as I said, definitely highly recommend going and listening to some of his press conferences. Such a great leader as well. Donnie said a few things positive about him there, so big respect for Theo on that. All right, last note out of the MLB before we get into some questions, we have big news. Actually, the Miami Marlins first female general manager in the history of North American sports, Kim Ng, takes over at that role. So yeah, that's great to see. I mean, get a little bit more diversity in terms of genders in management and GMs. It seems like the NFL is going the route that we'll give people draft picks if they make decisions like this. So nice to see MLB kind of be one of the first leagues to have that happen. And so definitely wanted to bring that up here.
Yeah, this is she's been around. She is not new to the game. She worked for the Yankees for, I believe, 4 or 5 years. She worked for the White Sox for like 6 or 7 years. She worked for the Dodgers for a decade during some tumultuous times where she probably added a lot of positive information. And she worked for the MLB. I don't know. There is no gender bias. There's no need for any of that, because anybody can do the job of general manager if you are educated and if you're qualified. I mean, it's like, gender doesn't matter, skin color doesn't matter, ethnicity doesn't matter, race doesn't matter. None of that matters when you know baseball. And I think that's the point. And that's what we have to leave it at. I mean, obviously we've seen football. A lot of people are mad about football giving draft picks to hire minorities and people of different genders and everything like about that. But I don't know. I think that this just makes a lot of sense. And she's been around for 30 years. excuse me. She's been around for...
Bless you, Donnie.
Yeah, thanks. She's been around for 30 years. And I think when you've been working in that capacity that high up and with that closely... to some of the best leaders in sports. I mean, it's like when you work with the Yankees and the Dodgers, you're going to be around some enigmas. You're going to be around people that have supreme baseball minds, if anything. So I think, you know, at this point, there's no reason not to give it a try, especially because she is as qualified as anybody else that would have been up for this position.
Yeah, good stuff. Love seeing that. Obviously, that was big news from this week out of MLB. So Yeah, good stuff there. We can now shift over to a bunch of questions we got this week. So looking forward to getting into that right here. We're going to start with a bunch of football thoughts. Then we'll get into some other sports as well. You guys know how that goes. So here we go. First question comes from my friend Matt at Matt_Mossbarger on Twitter. And he says, can you break down the final play in the Cardinals-Bills game? So yeah, really excited to do this. I mean, this DeAndre Hopkins catch, one of the best catches I have ever seen in the NFL. Literally Moss, like three different guys. So kind of the breakdown of the play. Cardinals, they're down by four with like 10 seconds left against the Buffalo Bills at home. They got a situation where they got DeAndre Hopkins just as the single receiver on the left side. Kyler Murray just kind of rolls out, figures things out a little bit, makes a little shake on a defensive end, just chucks it up in the air. It's literally triple coverage. Like DeAndre Hopkins literally has to make the most absurd catch over three defenders, including Tre'Davious White and Jordan Poyer, two of the better DBs on the Buffalo Bills. And he mosses them and just makes an unbelievable catch for the Cardinals to win this game. So, I mean, literally this is one of the greatest catches I can ever remember seeing, Donnie. What did you think when you saw this?
Nah, as soon as you saw him roll out, you're like, okay, so he's gonna lob one up and hope for the best. And you know Hopkins is out there somewhere. We've seen this a lot of times. We've seen this often. The Eli to OBJ was always fun. You know the fuck it, he's out there somewhere. Yeah. Memes were very apparent all the time. But I don't know. If you're a defender, there is nothing, you can't let this happen. I think that they probably teach you to not attack straight for the ball, attack the arms, attack the point of weakness. Because, I mean, it's like a guy like Hopkins works so hard. His hands are just maybe the best in the league. I'd say him and Julio are very, very much up there. I don't know. I don't know how you let the quarterback roll out and buy time and then find him in a one-on-three. You know, it's a little bit interesting, but I think they established that Hop had height on everybody. And he had a wingspan on everybody. And obviously, if you put the ball in the right position, which Kyler somehow did, and Hopkins got in the right position for it, anything can happen. I don't know. It's got to be devastating if you're a Bills fan. It's got to be devastating if you're a Bills player. You got to be sitting there just still. It's Wednesday right now, and you've got to be just absolutely stunned.
Yeah, that was unbelievable, that catch. I was watching that live on Red Zone, and I was just absolutely stunned. Another part of this catch I thought was interesting, there was the photo right where DeAndre Hopkins catches it over the three guys, and he was wearing Jordan brand like gloves, and that photo yielded 5.7 million in exposure to the Nike and Jordan brand, so shout out to marketing people out there. And then, but the funny part of this, so it yields $5.7 million in exposure for this brand. DeAndre Hopkins is not a Nike-sponsored athlete, so he sees none of that money. So, sorry. You just won your team the game, DeAndre Hopkins, but you're not seeing any of the money that Nike got from all that. So, shout out to that. Matt, who asked this question, sent me that article. So, great thought there. Unbelievable play. So, really glad we got to break that down there.
I feel like you got to think that there's something brewing in the background now with DeAndre Hopkins and Nike/Jordan. You got to think that there's something going on there.
The Super Bowl, we're seeing a Super Bowl ad with DeAndre Hopkins somewhere making that catch. It's just got to happen.
Just do it. You know, you see flashes of different pictures. You see Colin Kaepernick. You see, and then you see Hopkins with the hands up saying, nothing's impossible, something like that, you know. There's got to be something along the lines there.
No question. Appreciate that question there from Matt. Move on. Next question relates to the same game. This one comes from my friend Trey at Trey_Godbolt on Instagram. And he says, talk about some of the bad beats of this past weekend, including the Bills and Browns. So yeah, this same game, Bills Cardinals. So what happened in this game? So Buffalo is underdogs by 2.5 points. So if you took Cardinals -2.5, so Cardinals -2.5. So the Cardinals had a lead. Bills are driving. Josh Allen rolls out, throws this great pass to Stephon Diggs. Touchdown, Buffalo. There's like 30 seconds left. You're sitting, you're thinking, oh, wow, this is good. You know, I got, you know, the Bills, they're making things happen. You know, what's going to happen? So after then, obviously, the Cardinals come back. They get this unbelievable Hail Mary. So the Cardinals, they were down 30-26 that time of it. So they get the touchdown on the Hail Mary. So it's 32-30. So if you had Cardinals -2.5, and this was the last play of the game's over. Like, the NFL changed that rule a few years ago where if clock expires, you don't actually have to end up kicking the PAT. But on this Hopkins catch, there was actually 2 seconds left on the clock after Hopkins caught it. So the Cardinals are up by two. And remember, the Cardinals are favored by 2.5 in this game. And they have an opportunity to kick the extra point. You can kick it, and then you'll win by three, and you'll win your bet. The Cardinals, there's 2 seconds left. They take a knee on the two-point conversion. So anybody who took Cardinals -2.5 just gets absolutely screwed over on this because the Cardinals are like, no, we're not taking our extra point. We're getting out of here. This game's over. So yeah, it's a lot of people. Some people got screwed on that, even though like it kind of because they just kind of got almost bailed out by this Hail Mary. But the Cardinals were like, no, we're not covering. We're getting out of here with the win. Only people who bet Cardinals money line are coming away winners on this one.
Yeah, that's tough, man. That's very, very disappointing. But I don't think it was the worst beat of the week, obviously. I think you have to think the Browns, you know, you get a massive run out of Nick Chubb. For what? For what?
Yeah.
Okay, for what?
That was also...
It's a real for what.
Yes, the other part of Troy's question, you're talking about the Browns. So the Browns, 3.5-point favorites at home to Houston. The Browns are up 3 with about a minute left. They're just kind of running out the clock. They're like, all right, let's just kind of, you know, get out of here. No big deal again. But they're favored by 3.5. So people with Browns minus 3.5, they're like, man, I need a touchdown. And what do you know? Here's Nick Chubb breaking off like an 80-yard run. Looks like he's going to score. And he steps out of bounds at the 1-yard line. So the Browns can just take a knee and get out of there. 3-point victory for the Browns. They do not cover 2.5. So if you bet the favorites between the Cardinals and the Browns, you really just kind of get screwed over. But I'm with you on Donnie. I think if you took that Browns one, that's a little bit more screwed over than the Cardinals one. Because you almost got bailed out in the Cardinals one. The Browns one was just Nick Chubb like, nah, I'm not helping you out if you took Browns minus 3.5.
Bro, especially because you watched that piss poor football game from start to finish where nobody could score, nobody did anything at all.
10-7 the final.
And the most exciting play of the game, when you're up 3 already, so this would have put you up 2 scores with a minute left. I just want people to understand that, to acknowledge that. You would have been up 2 scores with a minute left. So chances are you going in the end zone probably the same chances of winning the game as kneeling the clock out. And he decided to go out at the 1. And I swear, there were probably people that had tens of thousands, like hundreds of thousands of dollars on that game. And they were like, they were screaming, so fired up to see that run happen. And then boom, he steps out. It's just, man, that's gotta hurt so bad. It's, especially if you're a fantasy owner, let's say you lost by 0.1 points or something like that. You lost by a couple points and you have Nick Chubb on your team. You just gotta be sitting there like just depressed, honestly.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Think of the fantasy owners in this too. That's tough. You just lost out on 6 potential points there. So, yeah, 2 really funny bad beats there. So, shout out to Trey for asking that one. We appreciate that. All right, we'll keep going here. NFL theme, continuing on. Bunch of questions on this one. This next one comes from our friend Eric at Eric18 Utah. And he says, so what exactly do the Broncos need to do to not suck every week? And for me, I think it just comes down to Drew Lock. You got to stop turning the ball. I mean, Drew Lock has kind of just been so up and down. And then I saw some stat that like Drew Lock, like 80% of the touchdowns he has had this year are in like the fourth quarter in garbage time. Like Drew Lock ain't doing nothing in the first half of these games. So, I mean, it's been tough. The Broncos have had some injuries as well, but obviously Von Miller not playing this year. That's obviously a big loss, but yeah, it's been tough for the Broncos. I don't know. That's a good division as well. So, I don't know. What do you think? What advice do you have for Eric here on this, Donnie? He wants to see some Broncos wins.
You know, I think you have to – they're in a tough situation as well. Obviously, they're not winning games. Locke has turnovers in 5 straight games. The only teams that they beat are, like, the Chargers, who beat themselves most of the time. It's got to be very disappointing. But you're definitely right on the whole turnover thing. It's like, trust me, I see Daniel Jones turn the ball over every week at least once. It happens. It happens all the time. I'm very used to it at this point. And when you lose the turnover – I think they lost the turnover battle 5-0 this week – which you're just not winning. You're not winning a football game if you turn the ball over 5 times and don't get turnovers back. It's just not going to happen. I don't know. You have to be semi-worried about Drew Lock's future if he's doing this now, especially considering he had a year under his belt last year to, you know, suck everything up and really just understand what was going on without having to play. Came in, played the last 5 games, was very good. And then this year it's been a total regression of what you were expecting, which is very disappointing. I think considering they thought that he was their future quarterback, now you have question marks there. On top of just, I don't know, there's question marks in general with the Broncos. I think they've got a lot of holes, and obviously injuries have not helped their cause at all this year, but they didn't have a chance to win the division in the first place. You were just hoping for a little bit of an improved season, maybe a little bit more steps towards being a wild card team. And I don't think you've got that out of the Broncos. And I think Drew Lock has been a major, major disappointment for basically everybody that was coming into the season thinking, oh, this guy could be great.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. Drew Lock, he kind of just came on towards the end of the year last year, had some nice games. I remember that Texans game specifically. He looked pretty good. But still feel like the Broncos are a pretty young team overall. I like some of their young talent. I like Jerry Jeudy a lot. Noah Fant, I think, is a good tight end as well. Cortland Sutton has been injured. But still feel like they have some potential there to be good. I don't know if necessarily Vic Fangio is their long-term answer at head coach. I think Fangio is an outstanding defensive coordinator, but at least when it comes to head coach, I think that offense is kind of lacking. So maybe the Broncos could kind of look for a more offensive-minded head coach for the long run. But yeah, I don't think the Broncos are too far off. I mean, there's definitely worse teams in the NFL than the Broncos. I mean, speaking from two fans of teams in the NFC East, but yeah, I mean, it's been tough sledding for the Broncos so far this year. So There's some thoughts on that one, so we appreciate that thought from our friend Eric on that one. We'll keep going here now to our friend Steve at Anders IEE. Of course, a couple different sports he wants us to hit on here, starting, continuing with the NFL. And he says, thoughts on Jamal Adams saying he went through depression in New York, and it was after the season the Jets went 7-9. So, I mean, kind of tough for Jamal. I mean, Jamal Adams, a player that won a lot with LSU, and then he went to the Jets, getting picked pretty early in that draft, and he was unhappy, obviously. There were a lot of rumors. Ends up getting traded to Seattle, so now he's back on a winning team. But, I mean, yeah, I mean, people go through depression. I get it, but, I mean, hey, like Steve's saying here, the Jets went 7-9. I mean, there's worse football teams out there than that. So, I mean, I don't know. Maybe Jamal's got to relax a little bit, but he's with Seattle now, so that's where he's sitting.
Yeah, I think it's probably more of the losing culture than anything. It's got to be depressing being on a football team that you know doesn't have a chance to win anything as a star, and I think Jamal Adams is that star. 7-9, maybe it's just the thought that you were close enough to be half decent, whereas you were not good enough to actually make the playoffs or you know, have a chance to win the Super Bowl. And obviously, the Jets have not been very good the last couple of years, and we've talked about this multiple times. The losing culture is real. It is very apparent, and it is currently growing. The losing culture is just getting worse and worse here. I don't know. Depression might not be the thing to talk about here. I would be more focused on just, you know, if Jamal Adams is coming out and saying that he was not happy with the Jets when they were 7-9, imagine how other players that were less got less play time or less exposure or had less chances to be successful felt. You know, it's like obviously 7-9, not the worst season in the world, but when you're on a Jets team that hasn't made the playoffs in how long, Mark Sanchez years, you've got to be sitting there like, oh yeah, you know, this is the reality of being a New York Jet. And that's a depressing thought.
Yeah. Even just that sentence you just said, the Jets haven't made the playoffs since the Mark Sanchez years. Like that is just a hilarious sentence that you just said. Like, I can't even imagine that's real. And it is real. So, yeah, interesting thought there. But, yeah, to your point, I mean, like, the Browns, they went 0-16. Like, what do you think some of the, like, backup, like, third-string safeties were thinking on that team? They probably weren't too thrilled either. So, I mean, yeah, stuff happens. But, yeah, interesting thought there from Steve. Move on to Steve's thoughts on his NBA team now, New York Knicks. Go to basketball. He says, should the Knicks trade for Russell Westbrook? Wouldn't help them do much in the long run, but wouldn't it be cool if they had a notable star player playing at Madison Square Garden for once? So I will say, I mean, you had Carmelo Anthony not too long ago, but yeah, it's been really bad for the New York Knicks for a long time, probably since like Patrick Ewing was really the last time they were like actually kind of relevant in the playoffs regularly. So I think that would be pretty cool actually if Russell Westbrook does end up getting moved. I know the Charlotte Hornets were another team that had some rumors for Russell Westbrook, so I think that would be a cool ad if the Knicks went out and got Westbrook and added him to play in Madison Square Garden.
It depends what they're moving, though. Let's say the Knicks added Westbrook, but they traded Mitchell Robinson and RJ Barrett. Then you're sitting there like, oh.
That is fair, yeah. He's got to have some help.
There goes the only two players on our team worth anything for the future, and we just got Russell Westbrook, who is not necessarily helping our team win. I don't know. If I'm the Knicks, I would stand put, play free agency as per usual. Draft, call it a day, go from there. Adding Westbrook, probably not a great idea. There are growing pains. The Lakers felt those growing pains for a couple years too. Trust me, I know. I've posted the lineup in our Twitter group chat multiple times when they had, you know, I was talking about Kendall Marshall and you know, the bums. We had absolute bums in the lineup. Robert Sacrae and, you know, Ryan Kelly. Yeah, this is who I was excited about. And trust me, I understand your pain. But I don't think Russell Westbrook is the answer, and I don't think you just add somebody just so that MSG looks good, especially because he can't play in front of the MSG crowd this year.
Yeah, I think that is also a fair point that you brought up. Like, what would they trade? I mean, like you said, they have a few young players, but then you're just kind of leaving Russell Westbrook out to dry. So I think it would be interesting if we did end up seeing it. I think that would be cool to see Westbrook play there. But yeah, I just think it just kind of comes down to the other talent around him. I mean, I don't think Russell Westbrook on his own is necessarily getting you a championship. I mean, isn't that your goal? So Steve kind of alluded to that here. He said probably doesn't help him much in the long run. So interesting thought. I mean, it definitely would be a star caliber player for the Knicks. But yeah, we'll see if that ends up coming to fruition, and if it does, what that trade ends up looking like. So good thought for us there from Steve. And Steve's got one more thought for us, and he says, can we finally let Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens in the 2021 Hall of Fame? So a bunch of different sports Steve's hitting. Now, baseball thought, this is actually like one of the more interesting discussions really in like all of sports. Like, should guys who tested positive for performance-enhancing drugs be allowed into the Hall of Fame? And it's a really interesting discussion. My view on it, actually, I think Barry Bonds definitely should be in the Hall of Fame. Like, I still think, even though he took performance-enhancing drugs, even though he took steroids, like, he still hit the most home runs in the history of baseball. Like, it's so funny to me that the all-time hits leader, Pete Rose, obviously that was for gambling, but and the all-time home runs leader, Barry Bonds, neither of them are in the Hall of Fame. Like, that is so interesting to me. Obviously, I understand why people don't want them in. Like, you literally cheated. Like, do you want to be celebrating players who cheated their way to have success? But at the same time, I get to take steroids, and I'm going to hit 750 home runs. So, for me, I'm putting Barry Bonds and Roger Clemens in the home run. Will the MLB? I think hell no. I don't think the MLB writers want them in. And that's clearly what's been shown over votes in recent years. So if it's me, I'm voting them in, but I don't think the baseball writers are in. So Donnie, interested to hear your take on this.
So my thought is basically if they add these guys, other guys that did not take steroids that were also Hall of Fame caliber players will not be able to make the Hall of Fame, considering the voting system is very, very flawed and very, very, I'd say baseball does a very poor job in terms of inducting players in their Hall of Fame. And at this point, if you're going to add in those guys, there's a lot of guys who took steroids that are going to need to get in at some point. Namely, Sammy Sosa is another guy that will, he's going to need it at some point. Obviously, you've got all of the bombers like Mark McGwire, who's going to need to get in at some point if you let in the others. So it creates a standard that steroids are okay, steroids are allowed, we're reflecting on the fact that, it wasn't that big of a deal, even though it literally shifted the entire history of baseball. It shifted how baseball functions. Now they randomly drug test quite often, randomly, they say. But I don't know. My whole thought process is if you start to let in these guys, you may have issues inducting other players who deserve it equally, considering it's taking a vote away from guys. So it's like, obviously, you're going to see guys like Derek Jeter who are going to get in regardless. But what about the guys that are like questionable or people that may not have as much support because they were on lower market teams, smaller market teams? I think it brings up, there's a lot of issues with inducting guys like Bonds and Clemens because it invites many other steroid takers to say, hey, I have a case too. Whereas there are guys that do deserve to be in that aren't in just yet.
Yeah, that's a great point. Honestly, that's not something that I thought about too much. Like, especially you brought up Sammy Sosa, Mark McGwire, two guys there that's like, yeah, where do we draw that line? At what point is PEDs allowed versus production? Like, where does that line kind of lay? So, interesting thought on that, Donnie, but like in terms of just like Barry Bonds in specific, like would you vote Barry Bonds in or out if you had a vote?
It would depend on the class of newcomers. I think this year's pretty mediocre. I think this year's headlined by like Aramis Ramirez and Tim Hudson. Great players in their own right, but not Hall of Famers. At this point, I don't know. It's a big question mark. And if you did vote them in, you'd be holding out guys like, so the examples are Omar Vizquel, who is one of the better fielders of all time, very, very, Scott Rolen, Billy Wagner, Todd Helton, Jeff Kent, Andrew Jones, and then you have the other guys like Andy Pettit, you have Curt Schilling, there's a lot of guys that are also question marks, steroids or not. I don't know. It depends. I do think they deserve to get in. I do think there should be they should be committee guys that get in after their 10 years. Once we reflect back on steroids and all that, I don't think they'll end up getting the voting. They won't get the votes they need probably, but I do think they'll get in at some point.
Yeah, this is a really interesting discussion. I feel like it comes up regularly, obviously, every time we have a Hall of Fame vote. Donnie, earlier you alluded to the fact that it's hard to get in the MLB Hall of Fame in general. You need 75% of every vote for you to get in. So obviously then if just 26% of people are like, no, if you took PEDs, you're never getting my vote, then those players are never getting in. That's just how it goes. So really interesting conversation. Glad that Steve brought it up there for us to discuss here. One of my favorite discussions in sports. So appreciate all those thoughts from Steve, as usual, good friend of ours. So we appreciate that. All right, we'll keep rolling here. Our friend Scotty G, obviously back with more questions. Not a surprise. At Sports with Scott on Twitter. First thought he's got for us. Top five favorite reverse retro jerseys in the NHL, and also our least favorite reverse retro jersey. So this was actually kind of interesting. The NHL released retro jerseys, as Scott's saying here, for all their clubs. So that was kind of interesting. If you want to check those out, you can definitely do that. We'll link it here. And then, so I'll go through it here. I'll go through my top five. I know we're a tier podcast. I know Donnie and I talked about this before we recorded. That's been established. Top five, not necessarily exactly five, but your top tier. So, all right, I'll shut up. I'll go here. All right. Top five jerseys for me. I'm going to start Anaheim Ducks. Really, anytime you get a Mighty Ducks jersey with the teal, I'm a fan, so they're definitely in my top five. I'm also going to go with the LA Kings. I love that purple and yellow combination. Big fan. Ottawa Senators, I now know because of our friend Owen that their logo is the head of a Roman emperor, or Roman general who is a member of the Senate of the Roman Empire. So I'm now just like a history god because of our friend Owen. So shout out to the Sens, but I also really like that jersey as well, the red and black combo. Big fan. Next for me is the Philadelphia Flyers. I love that orange and black combination. And lastly, I'll go with the Florida Panthers. Big fan of that cat logo. I know Scotty G, question asker as well. He's a fan of that logo and the blue and red. So I'm a fan of that. So those are my top five favorite of the reverse retro jerseys. Donnie, give me your top tier of these jerseys here.
I will agree with the Kings. Obviously, those jerseys are just classic. They're absolutely beautiful.
Those are fire.
Like, come on. Yep. They're so nice. The Colorado Avalanche, the throwback, the homage to their history. You know, you have to give that respect. I think that more teams should do things like that. I really, really enjoy looking at the Columbus Blue Jackets jersey, actually. Obviously, it's not that retro, but I do think that the colors and the logo are beautiful. You know, it makes a lot of sense. And then I'll add in one more. I'm not doing the top five, but I'll add in the Capitals jersey. I really like that the logo that they have, and I like how the jersey is made. It's very, very unique. With the little diagonal swoosh on the bottom, I think it's a nice little fit, and I think the Caps did a great job, and they have a great jersey there.
Yeah, I like the Caps as well. I definitely considered it in my top five. I'm a big fan of that jersey as well. So then Scott also asked our least favorite of the reverse retro jerseys. And for me, this is the New York Islanders. Like, I looked at the Islanders jersey and I was like, dude, this is just their regular jersey. Like, I didn't see like anything different between the Islanders reverse retro and their regular jersey. I wanted to bring them back like the fisherman logo that they had in like the 90s. That thing is hilarious. I want to see more of that. But Islanders jersey, it just looks like their regular jersey for me. So that's my least favorite.
Yeah, I think the Oilers is my least favorite because it's literally the same jersey that they normally wear, I feel like. There's nothing unique about it. There's nothing different about it. You'd like to see some sort of change. There's not much there. I'm not a big fan.
Yeah, fair enough. I heard a lot of people say that about like the Detroit Red Wings. They think that looks like a practice jersey. But I looked at the Red Wings. I was like, I don't think this is too bad. So I don't know. Maybe I'm in the minority on that. But good question there from Scott. Honestly, Scott always asks us so many questions. And like of all the questions Scott asked, this is like the most typical Scotty G question. Like, have us rank jerseys of the retro jerseys. I love it. So love that Scott asked that one for us. So we'll go on to Scott's few of his other questions now. Next one he's got for us is, if somehow Kyler Murray does not win the MVP, should we riot? And this is a funny thought. I mean, Scotty G, obviously Oklahoma Sooner fan, Kyler Murray fan. He knows that I'm a big Kyler Murray fan as well. I mean, that Hail Mary that he had was just ridiculous. Like, who was making that play? Like, Kyler Murray, just so exciting to watch. In terms of MVP, though, I think still Patrick Mahomes, Russell Wilson may have a slight edge over Kyler, but I think Kyler is definitely in that mix. I don't know if it necessarily he's the outright front runner right now, but yeah, that's kind of where I see things. Love to see Kyler actually in the mix on that after I very profoundly said that I thought Kyler was winning MVP before the year.
Yeah, you know, Patrick Mahomes is winning MVP. Debate your cat. I don't know at this point. I think at this point, you know, back to the initial question, Kyler Murray deserves all the respect in the world for taking a team that just a couple years ago was the laughingstock of the league, basically, and now they are up there. They are winning, and Kyler looks great. Kyler does it. A very unique quarterback game that we don't see very often. So props to Kyler Murray for being absolutely incredible.
Yeah, good stuff. We love Kyler on this podcast, as Scotty G knows, so we appreciate that thought from him. All right, we'll keep going. Next off from Scott, more Sooners love, of course, and he's got prediction for the Bedlam game on Saturday. Obviously, that's Oklahoma State. This year's game will be in Norman. Oklahoma is favored by 7, so I thought this was kind of interesting. OU absolutely dominates this series. OU's won 5 in a row. They lead the all-time season series 89-18. So absolutely dominant. OU always loves talking about how they always destroy Oklahoma State. I looked up this. Obviously, I found out what the all-time series was. Oklahoma State has never had a winning streak over 2 in the entire time that they've played Oklahoma. Like, they have never won 3 in a row over Oklahoma. I just thought that was hilarious. It's a little bit better of a year for Oklahoma State and a little bit of a worse year for Oklahoma. I still think Oklahoma is going to come out with the win on this one, especially given the fact that the game's in Norman. So that's kind of where I lean on that one.
Yeah, sure. I'll go with that. I mean, I just, you know, I think it's our weekly time to reflect on how bad the Big 12 is. I think that's all I
Fair.
Got for you. I mean,
that's a good
reflection. When Oklahoma State is like the fire me up game of the week, the fire me up game of the season for you in a conference, you know, maybe it's time to step back and realize, hey, you know, this isn't working. This isn't it.
We know who the real teams are in college football. It's Alabama, it's Clemson, it's Ohio State, and this year I guess it's Notre Dame. So, I mean, that's kind of what I'm thinking. Cincinnati's been going good too, but I mean, hey, when we're talking about the absolute powerhouses, it's not out of the Big 12 this year, so that's where he got. But yeah, I'm looking for more Sooner wins over Oklahoma State this weekend, especially given the fact that the game's in Norman. So that's my prediction for that one on Saturday. We can give a recap of that in our next podcast. So appreciate that from Scott. Scott's got two more for us. Next one's kind of funny. He says, favorite CFL team and why? Easy for me. It's the Ottawa Red Blacks. Our friend Owen, obviously he's from Ottawa, big Red Blacks fan. I think like the 1 year I followed CFL, the Red Blacks won it all and won the championship when they had Henry Burris. So there you go. There's my favorite CFL team. Donnie, let's hear about you.
Yeah, you know, I'll go with the Calgary Stampeders. I like their jerseys. I did research to look at the jerseys beforehand, and they have a black and red color scheme, and it's fire. So I'll give them that. I don't think you'll catch me watching a CFL game anytime soon. But if you do, hey, go Stamps.
Yeah, I don't think so either. Calgary, they must love that red and black combination. They got the Flames. They got the Stampeders.
Yeah,
I don't know.
It's fire though. It's fire.
Yeah. Good stuff. All right. We'll go on. Scott's last question. We were talking earlier about how the NBA draft is coming up for us later today, so you already know the answer to this question, but we're going to give you predictions. He says, who should the Chicago Bulls pick at number 4? So I've seen a lot of rumors of either Patrick Williams out of Florida State or Denny Avdija of Maccabi. I don't even know who this guy is. I'm not going to pretend like I got any knowledge on like either of these guys. But
you tried. Good effort.
That, exactly. So you already know who the Bulls pick. But you know what? I'm one guy I like in this draft that I think will be available for the Bulls at 4. I think kind of this draft, there's really a clear like tier at the top of the top 3 guys when it comes to Wiseman and LaMelo Ball and Anthony Edwards. So then there's a little bit of drop off after that. But one guy I like is Obi Toppin of Dayton. I thought he had a really good year. I thought he was probably the best player in college basketball outside of maybe Luka Garza. Shout out to Iowa. But I like Obi Toppin a lot. So that's probably what I would do if I were the Bulls pick at 4. But at least in terms of what I'm reading, it's either going to be Williams or Avdija. I don't even know this guy. Yeah, maybe he's a Bull.
Avdija. Avdija.
You'll get him next time. Okay. There we go. We'll see if I'm rooting for him for the next 15 years or not. It's kind of like a Tingus Pingus situation with Kristaps Porzingis, I'm thinking.
Yeah, I mean, but if you ended up with Kristaps Porzingis out of this pick, you'd be like, hey, you know, fire me up because KP's a good player. Yeah.
Give me his production. That's for sure.
You're going to go be top and you're going to like it. That's just how it's going to go. So congratulations.
Hey, I love it. It'll be interesting to watch kind of how that NBA draft plays out tonight. So obviously you guys know that already. So we'll keep living in the past on that one. But all right, we'll keep going on this one. Next question from our friend Hunter. Here he says, at the Primal Human off Instagram. He's got two questions for us. First one, should the Pepsi Rookie of the Week be renamed the Justin Herbert Rookie of the Week? So funny thought, obviously Herbert's had a pretty good year so far this year. But I mean, there's been other rookies that have been balling out. There's been a handful. DeAndre Swift, Justin Jefferson, Tua's kind of starting to pick it up a little bit as well. So I don't know if I'm necessarily giving Herbert the naming sponsorship on the Rookie of the Week. But yeah, definitely got to give respect for Herbert balling out on the Chargers team that really can never find a way to get wins. But Herbert's definitely been balling out. Now we're getting into our funny questions. End of the podcast, folks. You guys are awesome. So now we go. Funny thoughts from us. So in this next one, again from the Primal Human, he says, most useless fruit. So, I mean, this is an interesting thought. I don't know if this is necessarily useless, but I guess just one fruit that I'm not a huge fan of is raspberries. Like, I don't know. I'm just not a huge raspberry guy. Like, I guess in terms of me, I don't use raspberries because I don't eat it. So for me, I'm gonna go with raspberries on this one.
You know, as time has went on, I've realized that pineapple is a fruit that I am not a fan of. It stings the top of my mouth. I don't know why that happens. And it's very, very sugary, and I'm not a huge fan. That's what I got for you. I don't know. I'll go with pineapple.
Okay. So you're not getting the Hawaiian pizza?
I am not getting the Hawaiian pizza. I'm not a Cretan, though.
And that's okay. I'm not a huge fan of the Hawaiian pizza as well. I will have pineapples once in a while, but there you go. There's talking fruit on Roadie on the Horn podcast. Good stuff. So thanks for those questions, Hunter. Good friend of mine. So appreciate those thoughts. All right. Here we go. Two more questions in this podcast. It's been a grind. End of the podcast, folks. We got funny questions. Here we go. Our friend Josh, of course, at Josh Posniak on Instagram, says, talk about how you guys would fare in a fight against 12-year-olds. So Josh and I actually had this discussion over text recently, and Josh thinks that he could take on 12-year-olds, and Donnie and I are like, okay, let's just be realistic here. 12-year-olds, they definitely have the majority, and like 12 against 1, like they'd probably mess this up. Like I probably am not just like defeating 12-year-olds and like stiff-arming everyone like Derrick Henry. Like I don't have that much confidence in my ability to take down 12-year-olds in a fight. I'm just going to be honest with you.
Bro, you're telling me if a 12-year-old kicked you in the balls, like, you'd be able to function? I just, you know, as wishful.
And then there's 11 more of them.
Yeah.
Then there's 11 more.
Bro, once they get you down on the ground and pound, they're throwing elbows, they're throwing knees, somebody's kicking you in the back. You know, I just, It depends. If I'm going full out trying to just like absolutely knock out 12-year-olds, I think it'd be a different story maybe, but I still don't think I'd be able to hang. It's just a lot of people. It's like what they say when you'd be able to go out there and beat like a bunch of animals in a fight or whatever. Like let's say deer, 2-3 deer came at you. Are you beating them in a fight? The answer is no. The answer is you're absolutely not beating a deer in a fight. And I think it's the same, the 12-year-olds, especially because I've seen some large 12-year-olds in my day. You know, it's like, who says that a 12-year-old can't be like 6'3", 240? You know, at this point, anything can happen. And you know, it depends on the athleticism of the 12-year-old. It depends on the physical and mental strength of these 12-year-olds to be able to, you know, engage in a 12v1 fight. But I do not think that I'm winning that fight, honestly.
I love that comment, Donnie, because I feel like I always hear like the old man in the back of the room, like, oh, these 12-year-olds aren't built like they used to be. Like, that's how I imagine what you just said. Like, these 12-year-olds, they're fucking us up, I'm thinking.
People in general are not built like how they used to be. It's like, you know, when I was a freshman in high school, there were kids that were 6'6", 6'7" in my grade. Obviously not most of them, but if you're 6'7" at 14, like something happened somewhere along the lines. You had some crazy genetic malfunction or something that just made you ridiculously tall for no reason. But yeah, I don't know. Who's to say there's not a 12-year-old out there that's like, that's not like 6'1", 210, built like the next big wide receiver. Like, I don't know. Who knows? And I don't want to take my chances against 12-year-olds. That's all I'll say.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I'm not taking myself in that fight. Josh thinks that he could. But you know what? I if I could pick one person, I said it earlier, give me Derrick Henry. If I could pick one person to take on 12-year-olds, I'm thinking Derrick Henry is just trucking every single one of them.
But what happens when Josh's Gucci shirt rips, or what happens when Josh's Gucci belt gets taken off of him? Like, what?
That is true.
Then things.
That's his weakness. Like, yep.
He doesn't have the power without the Gucci belt, or the Gucci. He's probably got, you know, Gucci sandals or Gucci flip flops. You know, once those are off him, and you know he doesn't have his power, what's he gonna do? He's gonna lay there and cower in fear.
The Gucci belts is like Josh's like Batman cape. Once he gets it on, that's what shifts him up a gear. So there you go. Good thought there. Funny question from Josh. So we appreciate that one. All right. Last question for this podcast. This one comes from my sister Kira. Her usual spot in our podcast, last question. She loves that because she is the only end of the podcast folk. So shout out to Kira. But here we go. She says, how do you feel about kumquats? So, honestly, I had asked Donnie what this is. I didn't even know that this was a thing. Apparently, it's like a fruit, and it's not much bigger than a grape, but it's like citrusy. So, when I saw that, I was like, well, I mean, I like oranges, and I like the, what are they called? Clementines? There we go. I like clementines. I haven't had a kumquat specifically, but I imagine I would be a fan of it, because I like similar like fruit. So, there you go. There's my anticipated analysis.
You know, I'll say this. You probably would not be such a fan. They are very sour. As somebody who grew up in California, where I believe most of the kumquats come from in this world, or at least there are a good chunk of kumquats from California, I'm very indifferent. You know, it's like they're nice. They're fine. You know, it's like there is some sweetness involved. You know, you're just, it's not an orange. It's not a clementine. You're not getting that sweet, like, you know, juicy flavor. They're just little tiny grapes that are very, very sour. You know, I don't have any real opinion, but I do appreciate your sister following me on Instagram and explaining the Enneagram from or whatever. Hold on. She told me how to pronounce it. Give me a second.
Yeah, Enneagram. I literally just pulled this up as you said it. So there you go.
Yeah, the Enneagram. She told me how to pronounce it, and she told me that I am automatically a good person because I had wing two. So I just want to say props to her. I really appreciate her. You know, she brightened my day, and you know, you need that.
There we go. We love it. Shout out to Kira. Yeah. As we said, last podcast, we were like, hey, we need something more from our listeners. We need the feedback. So Kira provided. So big shout out, obviously, end of the podcast, folks. Everybody else who's listening, I mean, big shout out to you. You made it through. Obviously you're just the goat. I consider you my friend. That's really what it is.
Kira's my goat. Kira's my podcast goat.
We love it. All right, good stuff. This was a solid podcast. A ton of sports, honestly. We love it. We had a Wednesday record. We got NBA draft, kumquats, fruit, fighting 12-year-olds. I mean, really, what more could you ask for in a podcast? I love it, Donnie. But yeah, Donnie, I'll send it over to you. If you want to ask any rapper, I don't know, like, if you just want to, like, pick out some random rapper that wants to come on the podcast.
Right.
We haven't previously discussed this. Oh, really? What? Two Chainz. No way.
Two Chainz. Sheck West, if you want to come on the podcast, you know, you don't need to ask anymore. You know.
He knows. He knows.
If you know, you know. But yeah, we really appreciate the questions. We had a lot this week, dozens of questions almost. You know, props to people for giving us stupid questions or smart questions. You know, the sports questions are always good. Kumquats, you know, I'll take it. But we very much appreciate it, and we will be back again next week with the same shit show that we had here, the same shebang with, you know, so just make sure to ask your questions, leave us whatever you want, really just about anything. I mean, we do have some discretion over certain things. But ask us questions, we'll answer them. But we appreciate you listening this deep into the podcast. The End Pod Gang, obviously, Scott, you know, thanks, man. But we will talk to you again next week.
Peace, everybody.
Peace.